Good morning, and welcome to First Congregational Church of Atlanta. My name is Samson Thomas, and I am a junior at the Lovett School. I am a youth deacon, and I will be giving the call to worship today. Let us enter the city with God today and sing hosannas to our King. Let us turn away from the powers and principalities of the world and open our hearts to the Son of God riding on a donkey. Let us join his parade, surrounded by outcasts, the blind, and the leper. Let us follow the one who brought freedom and peace, and walk in solidarity with the abandoned and oppressed. Let us shout for joy at Christ's coming, and join his disciples, welcoming the broken, healing the sick, eating with outcasts. Let us touch and see as God draws near, riding in triumph towards the cross. Let us pray. Merciful God, as we enter Holy Week, turn our hearts again to Jerusalem and to the life, death, and resurrection of Jesus Christ. Stir up within us the gift of faith that we may not only praise him with our lips, but may follow him in the way of the cross. Amen. Amen. Those who are able, please stand and sing our opening hymn, All Glory, Laud, and Honor.
Children, make straight. Amen. Please be seated. Good morning, dear friends, and welcome to First Congregational Church on this wonderful Palm Sunday. We're so happy to see all of you here with us in worship on this day when we recount Jesus' triumphant entry into Jerusalem. This is a reminder of his path ultimately to the cross. And so we are glad that all of you are here so that we can recount the entire journey of Christ, his resurrection, sacrifice, and ultimately redemption for all of our sakes. We're delighted to have you here. And so I want to begin by sharing a few announcements and also by taking a moment to welcome our visitors on this glorious spring Sunday. So first of all, I'd like to have all of our visitors, if you would, stand. And we'd like to bring a microphone to you so that you could introduce yourselves, tell us your names and where you're from. Do we have any visitors today? Or are these all the children of the house? Okay, amen. We're going to come back to this couple in a moment, Michelle, and then we're going to bring them up to us. Great. Good morning, my dear friends. We're bringing a microphone to you. Excellent. We're coming. Excellent. Amen. Good morning. Good morning.
My name is Dr. Melvin Pender, my wife, Reverend Devin.
Oh my, all right.
It's great to be here today. Reverend Durley is a family, like family to us. And every time he preaches, we try to find ways that we try to make it there.
Amen.
Glad to be here this morning. This is my wife, Debbie.
Good morning.
And God bless every one of you. It's a wonderful for us to be back in the house of the Lord because we have been celebrating church at home for a period of years. And so every time we get to go out, it just blesses our soul. So thank you.
We're delighted to see both of you. Amen. Welcome, welcome, welcome. Glad to have you here. Amen. In this corner, good morning. Oops, first of all, we're going to turn on the microphone. Okay, and while we're getting you on, we're going to welcome this young lady right here. Good morning.
Morning, how are you?
I'm great, how are you?
I got stuck in an elevator. it was all good though, because I went up instead of down. So, yeah. Hi guys, I am working on articulation. I'm here with Ambassador Andrew Young and my dad. And I found God recently, and yeah, so I'm really blessed to be here, and yeah, I'm a student at Georgia Tech, so close by. I'm church seeking right now, and I've been praying about baptism, and I'm excited to see what that looks like, and I'm happy to be here, so thanks for welcoming me.
Amen, amen, amen. So happy to see you. And are you related to anyone in your pew? Yes, you are the daughter of Michael Varzi, who also found the Lord and found First Church. We're delighted to see you both here in worship. And thank you, Ambassador, for being such an ambassador for this church. We're so grateful for you. Ambassador Young, as all of you know, just celebrated his 92nd birthday. Preached a powerful sermon last week that we will be reveling in for some time to come. So thank you. Glad to have you all here. And now in this corner.
Hi, good morning. Well, I'm Nick. I'm a current MDiv student at Candler. And my friend Malachi just invited me to come worship with y'all. And I'm from a Methodist tradition, so just getting to see another style of worship is really interesting and fun. So thank you for having me.
Amen. I like the way the Methodists put it. You know, the Methodists say, we wanted to discover other ways of doing it. It's interesting and fun. So we're glad that you are giving us those plaudits and welcome. Glad to have you here. And Malachi, of course, is one of our seminary students who's studying at the Candler School of Theology, and we're so grateful for him. He's going to be hosting our college welcome table right right after worship. So to all of our college students at Georgia Tech, Georgia State, Spelman, wherever you find yourselves, please take a moment and join us for breakfast right after this worship service. Glad to have you here. Now we're going to, actually, I'm going to invite my dear friends to come up from home. T, to come on up. And Brother Victor, why don't you come as well so that you can introduce yourselves. They're going to be using this microphone and not the lavalier. But, you know, I grew up in Detroit, Michigan. Let the church say amen. And one of the great things about Detroit, Michigan is Detroit is a fantastic city with a fantastic history. And so I was quite surprised to see one of my dear friends, really from junior high school, who was a wonderful musician when we were kids and who has gone on to greater things. Since she was here, I wanted to give Dr. Tita Banks a chance to introduce herself. But I also want to make the connection between Tita Banks and her father, Dr. A.A. Banks, who was the pastor of Second Baptist in Detroit, which was one of the premier churches in downtown Detroit, an important part of the civil rights movement. He was a colleague of Dr. King's, and it was a part of the Underground Railroad. So it has a very, very important history in Detroit, and his progeny have done well. So Tita, come and give us a word of welcome, if you would, and Victor as well.
Well, thank you so much, Reverend Dr. Andrews, and to the ambassador, it's certainly an honor to be here, and to the congregation and the ministers in the pulpit here at First Church. I bring you greetings from Detroit, Michigan, as he's mentioned, and I also bring you greetings from the United Nations. I serve as the chair of the World Federation of United Nations Associations, and I serve with Dr. Walter Young as Consul General of Liberia. But I was out of Philadelphia. I wanted to express our gratitude to First Church and all of the churches associated for the outreach. We talk about foreign missions. So I bring the greetings and the gratitude from those people served throughout the world out of the work that you do. So you're in the work of not only saving lives, but saving souls. So I just want to say, I was glad when they said unto me, let us come into the house of the Lord, especially on this glorious Palm Sunday. Thank you.
Thank you. Vic, to introduce yourself.
Good morning, congregation. I have the honor and privilege of attending with Dr. Banks. I am a retired Air Force colonel. I am also a knuckle-dragging caveman aviator, so I've done that for 30 years, but I've done that in the Lord. And it's a pleasure and an honor to be amongst you worshiping today, so thank you for hosting us.
Thank you for being with us. Thank you. Amen. Thank you, Doc. Thank you. Let the church say amen. Amen. So you can see that Tita was just a child when we were growing up. I was much older, but she is doing wonderful work. And Victor, who I'm just meeting, we're grateful for his leadership as well. I want to now call your attention to just a few announcements because we have a full and rich Sunday on tap. All of these announcements are in our bulletin. I won't read them for you, but I do want you to be mindful of a couple of important dates. This is, of course, the beginning of Holy Week. So with Palm Sunday on this Sunday, we will then follow that with the worship service of Maundy Thursday, and then Good Friday, and then our Easter celebration. I hope as many of you as can will attend these special services that will all be in person, because they really do recount this important Passion Week for all of us. We always want to get to Easter, but sometimes we don't want to go through the Passion, what Christ endured so that we might have life and have it more abundantly. It's a beautiful service on Maundy Thursday, a quiet service where we hear through Scripture and being led by our diaconate, the Last Supper. And then on Good Friday, we learn of Christ on the cross. And then on Easter, we celebrate He is risen. All three parts of our Holy Week really are a tremendous path of understanding of what God has done for us and for our sakes. And so I pray that all of you as can will come and join us. We are obviously thrilled to have the Reverend Gerald Durley here, and we will give him a bit of an introduction, although he needs none, later in our service. We want to remind all of you that we are coming up on our Easter egg hunt, which will be on March 30th. And the Sunday School is hosting a bake sale on March 31st after the Easter service. So I hope all of you as can will celebrate with us and participate in all of these glorious events. We want to welcome our wonderful musicians. Let the church say amen. Amen. They bring a wonderful dimension. And on this Palm Sunday, we wanted to celebrate some of our classically gifted musicians here in the Atlanta area. And so we welcome Brandon Owens and Tia Roper, who is my flute teacher. We welcome both of them to our regular cadre of stellar musicians. And let's just say amen and thank them for their good work. You know, this church is blessed. We have Doug Hooker, who's going to be playing oboe with us today. We have Will Scruggs, who's going to be playing the saxophone with us today. We are just rich in musical talent. And so I'm so grateful every Sunday when we come to worship to know that we have such a cadre of gifted musicians who share their talents with us so freely. So welcome to all of you. We have in our program the idea that there's going to be a brief stewardship moment today. And believe it or not, I am the stewardship moment for all of you today. And I just wanted to kind of share just a brief personal thought about stewardship. You know, oftentimes we think about stewardship as giving our money, giving our tithes and our offerings. But of course, to be a good steward means that you have been entrusted with gifts from God and that you are a steward, not of your own stuff, but of what God has given you. And so I just wanted all of us to think, not just as we prepare for the offering, but in terms of how we live our lives, that we are all called to be stewards, all called to be stewards. And Ambassador Young gave a great sermon last week where, as he discovered God's creation, that God has everything for a purpose, and he also discovered in that God has a purpose for him, which he has been living out for 92 years. I thought about my own life, and I said, you know, God has something in mind for me, and I want to make sure that I purpose myself for God's purposes. And so in my own humble way, I'm asking all of you to think about it in the same way. It's not just about your money that God asks us to be good stewards of. It's your brain. It's your critical analysis. It's your communication ability. It's your loving. It's your holding hands with somebody that needs a hand to be held. It's your calling with someone who is grieving. These are all parts of our stewardship, giving out what God has given us, literally pouring it out. And so it's in that spirit that every time we come to the stewardship moment, I feel great. I feel great because God has given me so much more than I could have ever anticipated, asked for, deserved. And every time I put something in the plate or when I try to lift up my gifts playing the music, that's all a part of my stewardship. You see where I'm headed? My musicianship has nothing to do with me. It has everything to do with God. And so I try to lift it up because I got to do what God has given me a purpose to do. And I'm so grateful that I'm in a church home where I can bring every gift that I have, my gift at humor. Let the church say amen. See, nobody laughs, but For you visitors, I have great gifts as a stand-up. I haven't exhibited all of them, but whatever God gives me, I try to pour it all into my life as a vessel of God's blessings. And so it's in that spirit that I want to welcome you, not only today, but in all of your days, to be a good steward, to give not only of your tithes and offerings, but of your time, of your talent, and of your treasure. And believe it or not, my friends, in this world that is so desperately broken and wounded, your gifts going to God's purposes changes the world. Your gifts, your each one of you, when you spend your gifts for God's purposes, it changes the world. So don't underestimate your power in this moment. Use it to the glory of God. And so now I'm going to invite the trustees to come forward that all of you might share in this giving moment. Share what you can. Share what God has encouraged you to give. And I want to thank you in advance for your generosity. You'll now be attended to by members of the Board of Trustees. Thank you.
Full tithes into the storehouse, that there may be food in my house, said the Lord. And put me to the test and see if I will not pour out an overflowing blessing, so much so your storehouse will not be able to contain it. Let us pray. Merciful God, bless these offerings and those who gave them. Teach us to use them wisely and well, always for your purposes, to build the beloved community here on earth. These and all other blessings we ask in Jesus' name. Amen.
I want to invite now each and every one of you to prepare yourselves for prayer. I want to invite those of you that might to come forward and stand in this chancel area if you choose, or if you want to remain in your pew or at your kitchen table. Know that God will hear your prayers from wherever you lift them up. God is good all of the time, and all of the time God is good. But especially at this time when we pray together, beloved, this is when we remember just how good God is. As I look out into this congregation, I see so many stories. Folks that are in the midst of a storm, some that are coming out of a storm, some that will be in a storm tomorrow. But no matter where you are in God's creation, God has his hands on you, and God will keep you safe from harm. Beloved, if there was ever a time we needed to believe in the power of prayer, if we ever needed the Lord, we need him now. So I just want you to take a moment, still yourselves. We won't be too long, but we need to take a moment to thank God for all that he's doing in our lives and all that he's promised to do. And to be mindful of that promise as we live out our lives. Beloved, this is not a time for fear. This is a time for faith. And I encourage you now to use this moment wisely and well, that God might use you to be a vessel. Let us pray. Most merciful and ever-loving God, it's hard to not be full at this moment, because when we're quiet and when we think about the ways that you have blessed us, protected us, lifted us up, guided us, encouraged us, shielded us, we're full. We're full, Lord, because we know that whatever this journey is that we call life, we're so grateful, Lord, that we have a gracious God who is compassionate and forgiving and patient. Lord, you've been waiting on some of us a very long time. And we're so grateful, Lord, we ask that you might quicken our steps as we hasten ourselves to you. We ask, Lord, that you might help us to live more grateful lives. And Lord, we really pray that we are not paralyzed by the worries of this world. Remind us, Lord, during this Easter season, how we got to Easter, how you gave your son that he might give his life for us and for our sakes. No easy journey, but he was obedient unto your will, even unto the cross. Lord, Jesus died for us so that we might have life. He's done the dying, so help us to live and live more fully. Today we pray, Lord, for a world that is so broken and bruised, one hardly knows where to begin, in Haiti, in the Gaza Strip, in Africa, at the border. You picked the place, Lord, and we need you there right now. And the least of these need to be encouraged, Lord, that you can still be with them even in the midst of desperate turmoil and even famine and violence of unspeakable terms. But Lord, our prayer is not just for them, it's for us, that we might see ourselves and those who are hungry this moment, wherever they find themselves, where we might see ourselves and those that wake up in fear and go to bed in fear, that we might see ourselves as your agents, your not just social change agents, but your spiritual change agents. Let us bring a change into the world, Lord, even today. For those of us, Lord, that are grieving, we know that grief takes a long time. Give us the time that we need to move and push through the grief. And give us the courage, Lord, to live on the other side of loss. To live on the other side of loss. For those of us that are weak and in need of healing, we pray, Lord, that you would be the divine physician who has his hands on the divine physicians and the human physicians. That the angels that don't get the glory, like the nurses and the caretakers, the hospice workers and the palliative care workers, that they not be overlooked for the work that they do. Lord, we just pray for everybody today. And for those of us that think that we've been given a faith that we might not love, but hate and hold others accountable, Lord, help us to be more loving and live like Jesus. Jesus said, love your neighbor, even those that despise you. Let those of us who have been despised love our neighbors. Teach Christians and Jews and Muslims and Baha'i and every other faith, remember that we're called to love, the one principle of all faith. And Lord, when we get so full that it's hard to say thank you, help us to say thank you. Thank you, God. Let your spirit descend upon us. And for these and all other blessings, we ask in the precious name of Jesus. And the people of God said, they said amen. Amen and amen.
Good morning, First Church. The Old Testament reading today is Psalm 30, verse 5. The New Testament reading is Luke 19, verses 28 through 44. Both are from the New International Version. Psalm 30, 5. For his anger lasts only a moment, but his favor lasts a lifetime. Weeping may stay for one night, but rejoicing comes in the morning. Luke 19, 28 through 44. After Jesus had said this, he went on ahead, going up to Jerusalem. As he approached Bethphage and Bethany, at the hill called the Mount of Olives, he sent two of his disciples, saying to them, go to the village ahead of you. As you enter it, you will find a colt tied there, which no one has ever ridden. Untie it and bring it here. If anyone asks, why are you untying it? Say to them, the Lord needs it. Those who were sent ahead went and found the colt, just as he had told them. As they were untying the colt, its owners asked, "Why are you untying the colt?" They replied, "The Lord needs it." They brought it to Jesus, threw their cloaks on the colt, and put Jesus on it. As he went along, people spread their cloaks on the road. When he came near the place where the road goes down to the Mount of Olives, the whole crowd of disciples began joyfully to praise God in loud voices for all the miracles they had seen. "Blessed is the King who comes in the name of the Lord. Peace in heaven and glory in the highest." Some of the Pharisees in the crowd said to Jesus, "Teacher, rebuke your disciples." "I tell you," Jesus replied, "if they keep quiet, the stones will cry out." As he approached Jerusalem and saw the city, he wept over it and said, "If you, even you, had only known on this day what would bring you peace, but now it is hidden from your eyes. The days will come upon you when your enemies will build an embankment against you, encircle you and hem you in on every side. They will dash you to the ground, you and the children within the walls. They will not leave one stone on another because you did not recognize the time of God's coming to you." The word of God for the people of God.
Dear friends, Reverend Angela Dempsey Williams is not feeling well today, so I've been entrusted with giving a brief word of introduction of our guest speaker. I am thrilled to have Reverend Gerald Durley here today as our guest speaker. He has, for the last several years, been our Palm Sunday speaker, and each time he comes, he gives us a new word with powerful force and truth. Reverend Durley has lived such an extraordinary life, it's very hard to summarize in just a few words. But I do understand that he has now an autobiography that's available on Amazon, is that right? All right, so I'm gonna give him an advertisement, buy the book and then understand this extraordinary journey that he's been on since he was a teenager. As great athlete, as early civil rights activist, as a student in the movement. And then for the last many, many decades, he has been a leader in the civil and human rights justice movement, not only for churches, but for all of God's people. I'm proud to call Gerald Durley my friend and my mentor. You all are seeing two of my big mentors right here, Reverend Durley and Reverend Young. And you know, sometimes people need extra mentorship. I raise my hand because I need all the mentorship I can get. And I am so grateful that the Lord put Gerald Durley in my path. He has given me great wisdom over the 30 years that I've been serving you. And First Church, I love you, but there have been some tough times in this church, haven't there been? Yes, yes, there have been. And when y'all were acting crazy and I was acting crazy, I had to go to Reverend Durley to say, "Gerald, help me figure this out." And in each instance, he's helped me to get a higher perspective on not only my sense of purpose and my calling, but what it means to serve the Lord. So he's going to be his own best witness when he preaches for us today. But immediately after you hear our song of preparation, we're going to welcome the Reverend Dr. Gerald Durley as our Palm Sunday guest speaker. Welcome, Gerald. Glad to have you here. Let the church say amen. Amen.
Thank you. a place inside my spirit beckons from a hill. Sometimes I choose to visit, sometimes against my will. I take the long and sloping road as though I hear some rooster crow, and driven by a prayer I go to the cross. Whenever I resist it, I am not at rest. It hovers there, inviting me to be a humble guest. I need it daily, I know. So with my selfish tears in tow, and with my fighting fears, I go to the cross, and there I and so I will determine this cross to be my friend, and I will bear it in my heart until my pride is dead. Part of me tell it no, but Christ was there before me, so I'll follow faithfully and go to the cross.
There's a sweet, sweet spirit in this place. And I know in this place. And I know there are sweet expressions on each face. And you know what? I know. What I want you to do, filling us give God a hand clap of praise. Thank God. As the choir sang a few minutes ago, aren't you glad he woke you up this morning? Aren't you glad he got you out of your bed? Got you to the bathroom. Brushed your teeth. Got your eyes together. Put on your ointment on your knees and hips. Stretched a little bit. And got you to the house of God. Amen. I knew that I was in the right place when the baby said amen. Amen. Sometimes you don't know where you're gonna get your amen, but when the baby said amen, I said, I can make it right. I'm so honored and thankful to be here once again. And Trey always inspires me. The choir inspires me. When you get to be our age, you wonder where you're going to get your inspiration from that day. How many people are going to pat you on the back and smile and say, keep on keeping on. And today I thank God for those who are here, friends, Mel and Debbie Pender of many years, George and Janice Andrews and Daryl Lawson, those that have come and just said we'd be there. You know, people don't have to be nice to you nowadays. I see Gene Duffy is always there in the corner, and I thank God for those people. I'm a little nervous this morning, and the reason I'm nervous is because I just heard that Ambassador Reverend Andrew Young spoke last week. When I heard that, I started to get up and simply give the benediction today. But I knew that that would be inappropriate. So I thank God for one who has meant so much to me in my life. Starting in 1960 at Tennessee State. So don't be trying to figure out. I'll let you know, May 11th, I'll be 82 years old. And I don't feel no way tired. Oh, I might have an ache or two and have some pain, but I know how to find joy in the midst of my pain. Dwight and Desiree, Dwight, thank you so much for always thinking enough of me just to let me come by and say a few words that God has allowed me to read. And I thank God for you. You know, so many times we forget to just thank the shepherds of a house. We don't know what he might go through, but I can say I've seen over the last 30 years how you've weathered so many storms and you never let the storm get in you. All right. All right. Let's give him a round of applause.
Thank you, Lynn Austin. On days when I didn't know where I was going, you would always call and we could pray together. And I thank God for you. Eternal and almighty, divine, righteous God, the giver of every good, perfect, and excellent gift, it is once again that you've allotted a special time that Breath and Bridges might share the word, break the word, break the bread of life on such a special day. God, we just ask that the things that we say from our heart that will come straight through our very core to a listening audience, and maybe at the end of what you've allowed us to share, somebody will find the joy. They got up this morning and they wondered, how am I going to make it? Do I want to go, or do I want to be virtual today? And they said, no, because the powerful word says that if you are touched, and you're touched when you're in the house of God, one more time. Blessed is your servant, in Christ's name we do pray. Amen.
Amen.
You've heard the reading of God's word, read by Pat Shaw earlier from the book of Luke, the 19th chapter. And I just lift up three verses. But as they came closer to Jerusalem, and he saw the city ahead, he began to cry. Eternal peace was within your reach, and you turned it down, he wept. And now it's too late. Your enemies will pile up earth against your walls and encircle you and close in on you and crush you to the ground and your children within you. Your enemies will not leave one stone upon another, for you have the rejected, you have rejected the opportunity of God. And then in Psalms, the 30th chapter, verse 5, it says, his anger lasts a moment. His favor lasts for a life. Weeping may go on all night, but in the morning, there is joy. This admittedly is a rather strange title for a day with so many great moments, a day when a translation of a triumphant entrance into Jerusalem is prominent. How do you find joy in the midst of your pain? How does one find that they can find a sense of happiness when everything around them is so sad? Joy in the midst of pain, joy in the midst of misery. How do you experience joy when you're really hurting? How do you find and to overcome anxiety and depression when they become the bookends that keep you alive every day? How do you find seemingly the ability to get up and say, praise God, when you know all around you, you're not sure if you're going to even get up? Do your children hear you, or your grandparents, grandchildren around you? How do you find a sense of joy in the midst of a divided word? World held by a man with orange hair that's pulling us from all sides. How do you find joy? How can you find laughter ring forth in the middle of sorrow, which is overpowering your every emotion? Can joy and sorrow occupy the same space at the same time? The very suggestion that joy can be felt when deep pain is crushing you in is almost impossible. Yet Jesus teaches us on his entrance into Jerusalem that these two emotions can occupy the same space at the same time, and that they can abound. You can be in the midst of pain and still experience joy. Today, the Christian tradition has labeled this Sunday the beginning of Holy Week, Palm Sunday. This is the day when all over the Christian world we gather together to retell the great annual celebratory story about Jesus coming into Jerusalem. This was the first day of the final week of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ's life here on earth. He was successfully concluding the mission that his Father had sent him on. He had become fully human and lived among God's people, and he had taught them a plan to be redeemed, a guaranteed plan to come back under God's divine redemption. That was his plan. Like today, Pastor Andrews, you can have a plan, but Satan can displan. You can have an idea, but that idea can be shifted. Just like today, we have folks who in our congregations are filled with joy, but they're feeling a certain kind of pain, and they bring that pain to the pews every week. The hurts, the pains, the disappointments, the debts, the depths, and the divorces, where they're painful and they're sitting here shouting, oh, hallelujah, blessed be the name of the Lord coming. And yet pain is engrossing our very body. How do you find joy? Even when you come to God's house, when you know what's before you when you go home, how do you find joy when you leave here and go into an intensive care unit and your wife or your husband or your grandchild is dying? How do you find joy when you know that you love the Lord, but pain is all around you? Maybe I'm the only one that's ever faced pain. Maybe some of y'all are all sanctimonious on your way to glory and never faced a doubting moment. But every now and then, pain will steal your joy. Jesus' mission was to give his life so that we might find peace, joy, and an everlasting life. In the Old Testament, the animals were placed up on the altar. They were sacrificed. But in the New Testament, there was a new sacrificial lamb. He was fully human with all of the emotions, jealousy, hate, love, sadness, depression, laughter that makes us human. He felt betrayals and disappointments. He also experienced the act of kindness and acceptance. You know, I used to do a sermon called Wishy-Washy Saints. Pastor Andrews, I don't know if you've ever experienced wishy-washy saints. One day they wishing, and the next day they wasn't with you. Wishy-washy all over. But in the midst, it is not that we go through. We're merely human. Christ was human when he came into Jerusalem. On that ancient day we call Palm Sunday, Jesus boldly entered Jerusalem, not on the high-stepping steeds like the Roman soldiers would come in, not with all the drums playing and the trumpets sounding. He entered on a lowly beast, a beast of burden, a big-eared donkey, slowly walking along, a friend to the peasants, not a congregation of monarchs, a whole lot of people. He came in. Sometimes in life, in the middle of your pain, you got to walk alone. People will be cheering on all sides, and you don't know what you're going to do, but all the exuberance around you, but inside of you, you're feeling pain, and you wonder, does anybody know what I'm going through? So you put on a phony smile. You put a smile, and you're trying to make it through, but inside you're saying, God, please don't leave me. And you know God is there. But in the middle of your pain, can you find joy? The crowds were immense, standing room only. They were ecstatic, throwing their clothes down and shouting, look, Jesus, you've got a one donkey caravan. But that doesn't matter. We don't care what you're talking about. We're having a ball out here. We're having fun. We are welcoming you, the king. They waved palm branches and enthusiastically shouted, blessed is the king who comes in the name of the Lord. God has now given us a king. Long live the king. Let all heavens rejoice. Peace in heaven and glory unto the highest. Shouts of oh, Hosanna rang throughout the streets of Jerusalem. It was a joyous moment. It was a kairos moment when everything was so exciting right at the heart. Not wanting to have a January the 6th moment, others standing to the side say, hey, Jesus, come here. Hey, Jesus, stop these folks from making all this noise. Stop these folks from shouting. You're not the king. All the Pharisees were condemning Jesus and are trying to get all the people. And Jesus said, uh-uh. They said, look, you've got to stop this MJGR group. Jesus had the MJR group. It's not the mega, but make Jerusalem great again. The MJGR group. Wanted to make Jerusalem great again. They say, stop that noise. Jesus looked at them. They told him to be quiet. And Jesus looked at them and said, if I tell them to be quiet, the rocks will cry out. The leaves on the trees will shake. The birds in the air will squeal. The ants on the ground will begin to shout. When was the last time you've ever had to hold something down inside of you? When was the last time you knew you needed to shout, but you didn't shout? When was the last time you needed to say, God, thank you for another day's journey? When was the last? But something inside said, no, I'm in the wrong place to do that. But every now and then, you can't. If God's been good to you, if God has carried you through another day, If God has lifted you up in the middle of your pain, you got to at least wave your finger. You got to wave a napkin. You got to lift up and throw a foot out. But when God has been good to you, I don't know how you, if the rocks cry, somebody at First Congregational needs a shout out. God, you got me up. Thank you for my daughter who finally had that baby. We didn't like the boy, but we liked the baby. You ever been there? No, y'all ain't been there. But in the midst, you said, well, I guess she loves him, so I guess I'll be there. In the midst of your pain, when was the last time you could not hold that shout down? We can't do, sometimes you can't do anything but make noise. Shout. Some people don't shout the same way. Some people might just wiggle a twinkie, pinky. But you got to do something when the goodness of God floods your body. When nobody understands what you're saying nor care what you're saying, you got to find that joy in the midst of pain. This morning, I don't want to dwell on the enthusiastic crowds. I don't want to dwell on the waving of the palms. I don't want to dwell on the loud shouts, praises, nor the disgruntled opposing religious leaders. We preach this sermon annually every year. We stand before people for 25 years at Providence. I knew it was a time now. I've got to get up and give the usual sermon on Palm Sunday. Then I'll wait for Easter to do the usual resurrection. I don't want to focus on Jesus coming into Jerusalem this morning. I want to focus on Jesus' attitude, his state of mind, what he was thinking about in the midst of all of the joy, in the midst of all of the shout. Was anybody caring about what Jesus was thinking about? Jesus came in. He looked around. Every Hollywood movie, every Sunday school class that I've attended, you always see Jesus kind of coming in, waving his arms, smiling. But does anybody know what's going on in Jesus' head? Does anybody understand what he was thinking about when they were raising, waving all of the palms? Does anybody delve into his mental attitude on that day? Pastor Durley, you kind of stepping out of your bounds. How do you know what Jesus was talking about? You going to play some of your old psychology games and try to tell us what Jesus was thinking about? You don't know his personal business. You don't know all of the fears that he was going through. But Durley, be careful. Just because you're a psychologist doesn't mean you can go back 2,000 years and get into Jesus' head. But Jesus' head was no different than many of our heads. When we've been in the middle of the pain, when we've walked in and everybody's cheering us and we don't feel like grinning, we don't feel like laughing, we don't feel like saying thank you, but we've got to find some kind of joy in the middle of our pain. Thank you, First Church, for permitting me to explore the possibility and explain Jesus' own word. How he felt and what he was thinking. In verse 41, it says, as they came closer to Jerusalem and he saw the city, he saw all of the well-wishers, he saw all of the palm branch wavers, he saw all of the billboards, he saw all of the placards, he saw the signs that had his name, he saw the balloons falling. And it said, the Bible says, Jesus wept. The crowds were rejoicing. Jesus was weeping. This is the second occasion in which our Lord wept openly. The first time was at the tomb of Lazarus. There he cried quietly. But on Palm Sunday, some days you can't cry quietly. On that day, he uttered out loud a lamentations. He was mourning. He said, and he was like the prophet Jeremiah, when Jeremiah cried openly because he saw Jerusalem being destroyed. On that entry into Jerusalem, he cried because God's people had destroyed themselves. Sometimes it might not be you, but you see somebody in your family going through a lot of trauma, a lot of turmoil, and you sitting there and you want to do something, you want to say something. You see a young person that's going astray and you want to say something, but you're too old. Your words have no meaning. And you see the pain that they will go through, the pain that they're in, and you say, how do I say it? Am I to be quiet? But if I'm quiet, if I don't teach, if I don't share, if I don't love, the rocks will cry out. So we stay and languish in pain, holding down that pain. But in the middle of the pain, there's always joy. Jesus looked back. He saw how the nation had wasted its opportunity. When he looked back, he said, look at y'all. Y'all didn't even know I was here for 3 years with you. And he started crying. If he looked within, he saw spiritual ignorance and blindness in the hearts of the people. They should have known who he was because God had given his word that he would send his son. As he looked around, Jesus saw religious activity accomplishing all around and doing nothing. There is nothing more sadder, I think, in 2024 than to see all the religious institutions practicing religiosity and the world getting worse. Yeah. I can't stand another cliche Christian. I don't even want to be around a cliche Christian. Darley, what's a cliche Christian? The Lord will make a way out of no way. Blessed be the name of the Lord. The Lord is ever too wise to make a mistake. God is a good guy, and they live in lives of hell. When do we take the cliches and allow them to be a part of our psychological and spiritual well-being? When we say the Lord is ever too wise and we believe it. But around us, next to us, maybe even us, we're saying all the things. Look at us today in a divided world, a world where they're fighting in Gaza and the West Bank, and world that's fighting right here in Atlanta. And we got every church and we got people. Bless you all who are on virtual. I'm not talking to you. But there are folks now that says, I can't come to church on Sunday morning because COVID is not gone yet. But they were at the juke joint last night. They had flew to the ACC tournament. I got back last night and I saw North Carolina be so-and-so, but they can't come to church on Sunday morning. The black church is powerful, and we say that we made it through on faith. But I contend it was a five-letter word, but it wasn't faith. What made us strong was a five-letter word called T-O-U-C-H, touch. I never could have gotten to where I am now had Sister Bickham not touched me. Had Grandma Jackson not told little Janie, Janie, pull your dress down, here's a little piece of peppermint. It's the touch. It's hard to touch virtually. I understand technology. But every now and then, y'all, if you're well, if you're feeling well, come on into God's house and touch each other. It's the touch that made us strong. When you're at your job, you don't want somebody, well, I'll text you in a minute. You want somebody to say, come here, let's go by this machine, let's talk. That's what made us strong. Nobody was touching Jesus that day. They were yelling. They were stringing, and he looked around and he saw the religious institutions weren't doing anything either, because with all of the hoopla, people really did not know that God had come and lived among them. John 1:11, he came unto his own, and his own received him not. Luke 19:14, they said, we will not have this man reign over us. Jesus was in pain as he entered Jerusalem. Jesus was hurting after all he had. He was human. And when you deal with us's, when you deal with us's, I don't know if that's a word that I would win in a game, us's, but I mean, when you deal with some of us, we can be cantankerous. We can be mean in the name of Jesus. And when you go through that, and we don't want to be bothered, we know everything, and we tell everything, and we put a person up there in the pulpit, or we have a deacon or a mother's board, but every now and then, you got to go deep down inside and feel your pain, and where do I find, how do I get out of this pain? I got to find some joy. Jesus was feeling that way that morning. In the midst of pain, he was experiencing. How did he find joy? One way, he remembered what his ancestor David said when he dedicated the temple in Psalms 30:05, for his anger endureth for a moment. In his favor is life. Weeping may endure for a night, but joy will come in the morning. Whatever you're going through, it will pass. Whatever you challenge right now, I never thought, and excuse a personal reference, I never thought that I'd be standing here this morning saying to a group that in the middle of your pain, find your joy. Not me, not Mrs. Durley's boy, born to a 16-year-old mother, going through that, the oldest of eight, making it all the way through, joining God's team. I'm on your team, God, preaching the gospel for 25 or 30 years. I never thought I'd feel the kind of pain that all of us have experienced. I never thought after 54 years of marriage that my wife would just die. And 1 year later, my son. And I said, God, I'm on your team. I'm on your team. Put me in the game. I'll prove it. He said, my ways are not your ways. Neither are my thoughts your thoughts. So whatever pain you're going through, know that joy will come in the morning like a shot. When you go to the doctor's office, he gives you a shot for the discomfort. And the pain will only last for a while, but the cure can last for a long time. At night, we may cry, but when morning comes, we can celebrate. We find joy in that. Even having a sleepless night. Anybody had any sleepless nights here? I'm the only one. One man said, I know how to help you, Reverend. I know you love the Lord, but this melatonin will help you. I had to learn a milligram of melatonin, too much melatonin. No, don't use that. Use NyQuil. And I'm still tossing, my mind just running. Oh, everybody give me some advice. Finally, I found out how the seniors up at a senior citizen's home in Buckhead, how they find the peace. I went up there, very exclusive, very few of us there, and I went to lunch, and I looked on the table, and there was a little package next to all of the people up there in the nursing home. And they said, we give them this so that it will improve their appetite, help their arthritic pains, and help them to sleep at night. I said, sleep at night? What is it? He said, it's a gummy. Oh, I got some gummy users up in here. Is it TCB or BDG? They didn't care. It'll help you sleep at night. Boy, Dwight, start my car. I don't think I'm coming back. You'll face, First Church, you will face some difficult days. You will face some difficult moments. Has death visited your home lately? Have bills piled so high when you thought your Social Security was right and it just didn't get right and you tried to call and stayed on the phone for 2 hours only to find out you got switched over to another dial and it lasted 2 hours? Have you ever been just misunderstood? In your retirement years, are you wondering, could I, should I, did I do all that I could do? Have you ever felt abandoned, alone, that the world is passing you by? Children and grandchildren, we realize that they have their own lives. You want to advise them, come on, why don't you come over this? Why are you wearing them raggedy jeans? How come your hair so, and all of these things, but they don't listen. Everybody is having fun, joyful, and you're in the midst of pain, even though you know and love the Lord. People all around you seem to be receiving the blessings from God around their health and their financial security, and you are wrecked with pain and trying to make some sense out of nonsense. How do you find joy in the middle of your pain? Nehemiah 8:10 said, do not grieve, for the joy of the Lord is your strength. Psalm 16:11, you will be filled with joy just being in his presence. Psalms 126:6, those who sow tears shall reap joy. Those who go out weeping, carrying seeds of joy for sowing, will return singing joyously. And my favorite scripture that I love is Revelation 21:4. God will wipe away all tears from your eyes, and there will be joy, no more pain, no more death, no more suffering, no more crying when you come through. These are the things of the past that are forgotten. And if I can understand that in the middle of grief, grief doesn't have to be bad. Grief can be a reminder of the good times in your life. They said, Dr. Durley, I'm so sorry you lost your wife. I said, no. I've lost my glasses and I've lost my keys. But lost means you don't know where it is. I know where she is. Therefore, she ain't lost. Don't ever tell me she's lost. Don't ever let anybody tell you, I'm sorry you lost your grandma if you know where grandma is. Man comes up to me, Dr. Durley, I'm so sad. You know I lost my wife. We'll be together soon. I say, how you going to be together soon if she's lost? If you don't know where something is, you find the joy in the middle of grief and dying when you know that God has your back. Yes. Never leave, that God will never leave you nor forsake you. Never turn a deaf ear, but will give you peace that surpasses all understanding. Comfort in the middle of your pain. Rest when you're tired. Hope for tomorrow. Love for eternity, that he will give you joy. Yes. And I love what the Bible says, unspeakable joy in the midst of your pain. Lifting your depression, lifting your doubts and fears and anxieties. God is not slack concerning his promises. feel today as you leave this place that whatever you're going through, that there is a God that has never ever turned a deaf ear. Continue to pray, but what good is praying? It's the belief in the prayer. Wherever you are, whatever you're experiencing right now in your life, feel God's love, feel God's grace, feel God's mercy overpower you even as you sit here. Even as you say, what is he up there screaming about? What is he hollering about? I'm saying to you, you can find joy in the midst of your pain. And when you find joy, how do you know you got the joy? And it starts coming on you, and you don't know, you can't control it. You might say something, thank you, God. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. And the more you say it, guess what? Pretty soon people think you nuts because you're screaming. Just like they shouted, oh, Hosanna. You said, thank you, Lord, for one more day. Thank you, Lord, for one more peace. Thank you, Lord, for the comfort I feel inside. You've been so good, better than I've been to myself. You've been so good when I wanted to quit. Anybody in here ever wanted to give up? Anybody here ever wanted to turn around? Anybody here ever doubted that God has blessed you even though you're breathing and walking? Got a reasonable portion of your mind? God, you've been so good. On this Palm Sunday, as we wave our palm branches and praise God, I feel your joy coming on in the midst of the pain. My loving Savior, I say like this, if Jesus can ride into Jerusalem, knowing in 5 days later what he would be going through, he saw it. He understood what was happening. We might not be able to see the future, but you're going to run into something. You're going to have some pain. You're going to have some disappointment. You're going to have some frustration. You're going to have possibly some depression. You're going to have birds of anxiety grabbing and pecking at your very core. But in those moments, know that joy will come in the morning. You're going to face a Good Friday, but it's not this Friday. Continue to raise your branches. I know I've got something to shout about when I can get up here and stand. And all no cane, no walking thing. When I can look out and see an Ambassador Young who did it for 92 years. And I say, if you can do it for 92 years, I thank God for that. There was a song written. It wasn't a Christmas song, but they started and made it a Christmas song. I wish we would sing this song every Sunday morning in our worship service. It's called Joy to the World. The Lord has come. Let earth receive its King. That's what the joy is about. This is the day that God has made. I will rejoice and be glad in it. So enjoy your pain. Enjoy today. In the midst of your pain, know that there's a God that's never left you, never walked away. When you get in your car, you say, Lord, this is a good day. This is the day that you've made, and I will rejoice. And if anybody is coming through that moment, if anybody is in that moment, if you're overcoming that moment, I want you to just say right now, thank you, God. Give God a hand clap of praise. Thank you for lifting you. Thank you for holding you. Thank you for never letting you walk away. Thank you for being a good God. Thank you for helping you through the joy and the pain. God bless you. Walk on. Don't bend. Don't bow. Don't break. And don't back up.
Oh, If I lose my life, I will find again. I will soar on eagle's wings, and then ever cease from war, rest in Jesus' arms. For the Lord, He's good, and I am safe from harm. Well, it's the Lord that gives, heard the prophet say, and I will bless His name, though He takes away. I will trust, not fear, not to be alarmed. For the Lord, He's good, and I am safe from harm. I'm safe. For the Lord, He's good. My soul is safe from harm. So when the tear ducts swell and my strength has gone, I will still believe in His name I call. He will rescue me for dust turns to dawn. For the Lord, He's good, and I am safe from harm. I'm safe. I'm safe. In the eye of the storm, there is calm. For the Lord, He's good. For the Lord, He is good. Oh, for the Lord, He is good. My soul is safe from harm. Thank you.
Scripture says, for the Lord is good, and God is good. Reverend Durley never disappoints. Every Palm Sunday, the preacher has to come into the pulpit and to find something in that scripture that will further illumine our journey to Easter. And Reverend Durley never disappoints. He helped me to hear some parts of that passage that I never heard before. What was in Jesus' head? And so often, my friends, we overlook that Jesus wept as they were rejoicing. Jesus wept. Thank you, Reverend Durley, whose life is a testimony itself to finding joy in the midst of pain. Some of you will remember when he lost his wife. And that next Palm Sunday, he was here in this pulpit preaching to us about having trust and joy in the midst of great pain. Beloved, we want to open the doors of the church and say, no matter what you're going through, no matter what point you are on this journey called life, we want to welcome you into not only God's house, but into the body of Christ. I do believe that we are a community of faith because we need each other. And as he said, we need to be able to touch and be touched by one another. If you're looking for a church home, you can join us this very day. If you feel you're too nervous to come down the aisle, you want to call me so we can give you a little courage to come down the aisle. But we want you to come down the aisle. And I hope... Oh, come on. Can you come up? Let the church say amen. Welcome. Come here, dear sister. Come on, please. God bless you. Come here. Let me get my. I'll tell you how.
I just know how I got moved by it.
Okay, good.
So much.
Good. But we'll tell you how it works right now.
Thank you.
God bless you.
God bless you. So now I'm going to start crying because God is so good. God never disappoints. We want to take a moment. I'm going to allow each of these folks to introduce themselves so I don't mess up their names, but then we're going to take them into full fellowship today. Let the church say amen.
Amen.
Amen. Come on, dear. Give us your name and tell us who you are and where you're from and just a brief word. Oh, actually, you can do it on this. Okay.
Hi, my name is Christina, and I'm a student at Georgia State. I'm an out-of-state student. I originally came from Pennsylvania, so I've been looking for a church home, and I literally live right up the street. So I started coming for Wednesday nights for the Lent services, and the last service, I actually talked to the Reverend, and I told him that I was going to be here. So glad I committed to that because I've been oversleeping. But
Welcome. Glad to have you here. Let me let y'all introduce yourselves as well. And come on so we can get you right on the placing camera.
Which mic to use?
Doesn't matter. They all work.
Good afternoon. I'm Tara Buckner. And I'll let my husband introduce himself. We are coming from, we lived in St. Louis for 20 years. I was raised in Minnesota, and so I find it truly a blessing that Dr. Johnson is here, who once hired my father as one of the first African American professors, or for the African American Studies Department at the University of Minnesota.
Wow.
So thank you for being here.
Amen.
But we're coming here. We have been watching. We've visited a few times, and then there was the pandemic. But we have been watching faithfully. And thank you, Dr. Pettislow, for doing such a great job of filming this.
Amen. Amen.
Good afternoon, Pilgrim. I'm sorry, our last church was Pilgrim. first church, very happy to be here. My name is Aaron Swain. We were here many, many years ago in college, and we've been back just a few years, but we feel this is our home, and we're happy to be here. And I'm very happy we're finally joining as well. We're planting our roots here. So thank you so very much for all you do.
Amen. Yes. Welcome, welcome, welcome.
I'm also a native Detroiter.
Oh, you're Detroit?
I am, yes.
Amen, amen. Glad to have you both. And come to the center just to reintroduce yourself briefly, and yeah. Then we'll tell you how this works. Y'all are fine.
Hey, guys. My name is Tara Marzi, and I just wanted to say how much I felt God's presence in this room this morning. And that I found a friend of Jesus today. I found God recently, a couple weeks ago, but I've always had a friend in Jesus, but today it was different. And it was
Reverend Durley.
So I just wanted to say thank you. And I believe I've known Andrea, Ambassador Andrea, for a long time, and I've seen how much he's poured into my dad's heart and how much he's poured into my heart, and I just see God working through my father, and just wanted to say that I felt his presence very much this morning, and I hope I can call this home. I might need to give you a phone call later tonight.
Okay.
Just because I just need to work on articulation, but it felt right for me to come up here and
amen.
Share with you.
Amen. 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 What a wonderful blessing it is on this Palm Sunday to receive these folks into membership. I'm going to ask you guys to come a little bit closer to the center so that we can get you on camera. And beloved, we're going to have our program to receive our new members that will come up on the screen. But first, we have these words of introduction so that you can affirm your faith. And believe me, it is a thrill for us to have you and to bring you into the body of Christ today. Hear the words of our Lord. You did not choose me, but I chose you and appointed you that you should go and bear fruit and that your fruit should abide. Everyone who acknowledges me before men and women, I also will acknowledge before my Father who is in heaven. Jesus Christ has chosen you and in baptism has joined you to himself. He has called you together with us into the church, which is his body. Now he has brought you to this time and place to unite with us in the ministries and blessings of this congregation. As you come into our midst, we invite you to reaffirm your faith as members of the Church of Jesus Christ. Do all of you reaffirm your faith in God as your Father, in Christ as your Lord, and in the Holy Spirit as your strength? If so, please say, I do.
I do.
And do you promise to participate in the life and mission of this family of God's people, sharing regularly in the worship of God and enlisting in the work of this congregation as it serves the community and the world? If so, please say, I do. Let us, the members of First Congregational Church, United Church of Christ, express our welcome and affirm our mutual ministry. Would you all please stand? Let us say together, we welcome you with joy as partners come in life of this church. We promise you our friendship and prayers that as sharing the hopes and labors of this Church of Jesus Christ, God grant that together we may grow in his knowledge and love. Amen. On behalf of First Congregational Church, I extend to you the right hand of fellowship. Welcome, welcome, welcome. Welcome. The congregation may be seated, and I'm going to ask Reverend Durley, who moved these folks to this moment, to offer them a prayer of blessing. Reverend Durley, would you come and bless these new members of First Congregational Church? What a blessing. Yes. Amen.
Our hearts and minds are clear.
Yes.
Because he lives.
Yes.
I can face tomorrow. Because he lives, all fear is gone. Because I know who holds your future here at First Church and life. It's really good because he lives.
Yes.
Eternal and almighty, divine, righteous God, the giver of every good, perfect, and excellent gift. It is once again by your divine providence that you've reached down and touched four persons.
Yes.
Who said, I can no longer be quiet.
Yes.
I want to be a rock. And I want to cry out and rededicate my life to you. Be blessed in this congregation to be a living witness to all who might see your life. God bless them. Let them know that this is just not an occasion, but a Kairos moment. And that God will not only be with them as they've made this decision, but he will be with them as they continue to grow. God, grant them the ability to understand that congregations are only as strong as its weakest link, and they make them a strong link. That not only will this congregation grow, but that they will grow, and that they grow, and that the congregation grows, and this community will grow. Bless them now. Anoint them. Touch them. Lift them. Hold them. And let them know that they're in the right place at the right time for the right moment to complete the right mission. In the name of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ, we do pray. And all those that want to welcome them, be a rock right now and let them hear it.
Amen.
Amen. Amen. Oh, that'll be some joy in this house. It's some joy.
We're going to let you all return to this first pew, if you would, and then we can ask you to remain standing so that we can welcome you after our service is over. Amen. Yeah. What a great day it is to take these new members in, to be filled with the Holy Spirit, and to have Reverend Gerald Durley as our preacher. Before I ask him to give the benediction, I want to take a moment to acknowledge the wonderful participants and leadership in our service today. This service would be only partially great with this great message, but our music ministry has done such a special job on this Palm Sunday. Amen. To all of you, I'm very, very grateful. We want to remind you that next Sunday there's a special day happening at First Congregational Church. It's called Easter. And so we hope that you all would join us. Now I really feel the heat is on, Jerry, because Andy was last week, you're this week, and now I got to preach next week. So y'all pray for me, and I'll see what the Lord will give us to deliver. Let's invite Reverend Durley to come back and give us the benediction. And then after the closing song, I invite you all to come and welcome our new members. They'll be standing with us in the chancel. God is good all the time. Come on, Reverend Durley, give us this benediction. Amen. Amen. You too good.
Man, this jumping up and down, this is the most exercise I've had in months. Next time, just let me stand right there. I don't have to get up. My knees would be grateful. Thank you so much for allowing me to come and allowing God to speak through me. I said in my message that sometimes you get tired of cliche Christians, and I get Trey and singing aggregation. I get tired of cliche songs. And one song that I had to say and I learned when people come to church, they sing, "I'm on the battlefield." Oh, they get up and they shout. Wigs fall off. Teeth come out. "I'm on the battlefield for my Lord." But I'm glad to be at First Congregation because you're not on the battlefield. I need some folks who are in the battle. Not on the battle. See, I know folks been on the battlefield, they ain't got a scratch, ain't got a moan, ain't got a divorce, ain't got a debt. But when you've been in the battle for the Lord, this is what it's about. Let's stand to receive the benediction. Is that the protocol? Let's stand to receive the benediction for those of you who are in the battle. When you leave this place, you will be in the battle for our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. Thank you so much for this day. Thank you for what our eyes have seen, our ears have heard, what our hearts have felt. Thank you for those that have made a commitment to work here in your vineyard here at First Church. Now, as we depart from this place, God, let us lead with a renewed sense that will not just be something cliche, that will be transformative. How do we know that we've been transformed? Because when you walk into the CVS, when you walk into the Kroger or the Publix, somebody will look at you and say, there is something different about that person because they've been with Jesus. In the middle of his pain, in the middle of their pain, they're giving me joy. Now unto him who is able to keep you from falling, faultless before the almighty hand of God, and all his majesty and good witness, be the blessing. Go in peace, go in love, and go in joy. In the name of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ, amen.
And may your battles end the way they should. And may your bad days prove that God is good. May your whole life prove that God is good.
May your struggles keep you the cross, and may your troubles show.